Okay, the final item of business this evening is a member's business debate on motion 5615 in the name of CoCab Stewart on changing the boundaries, ending institutional racism in sport. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members who wish to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on CoCab Stewart to open the debate for around 7 minutes, Ms. Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Firstly, I'd like to offer a warm welcome to the visitors in the gallery, to so many individuals and organisations, including colleagues from Running Out Racism, Showing Racism the Red Card, Active Life Club, the SDUC, amongst others that work tirelessly to eradicate racism in all its forms, including sport. I acknowledge the overwhelming cross-party support for this motion also, and we are all grateful for that. This is indeed an uncomfortable topic. Recognising the existence of institutional racism is to admit to years of apathy as people suffered around us and to accept that processes and structures designed without all voices present have caused harm and affected the achievements of so many. If there is one clear message we should take away from the debate today, it is that we need to get comfortable with being uncomfortable. For it is in that discomfort that true change can take place. Today we reflect on the findings of the Plan for Sport independent review into racism in Scottish cricket, and I commend Sport Scotland for commissioning this review. It's never easy for anyone to come forward, often suffering negative impacts on career, family, mental health. But it's because of their bravery that we now have a chance to reflect and move forward in the true spirit of sporting endeavour. Maya Angelou said, "When you know better, do better." And this is our chance to do better. Woven throughout this damning report are themes of an absence of leadership, lack of accountability, transparency, and overall loss of confidence in the incident report handling processes. 448 examples of institution racism were identified against the national governing body, Cricket Scotland. Sir William McPherson, in his 1999 report of the public inquiry into the death of Stephen Lawrence, defined this as the collective failure of an organisation to provide an appropriate and professional service to people because of their colour, culture, ethnic origin. And this is the definition that is referred to by the authors of the review. From participants, we heard that there were too many close friendships in Cricket Scotland for confidentiality requirements to be upheld. That people who had previously raised concerns were victimised as a result. And the familiar old adage of "it's just banter" invoked as a means of silencing those who spoke out. At board level, there was no overall vision or strategy for tackling racism and a total lack of diversity in workforce and governance procedures. But while the findings of the report are certainly alarming, it is vital that we not only consider the consequences of our inertia, but we seize this opportunity to learn. And I am grateful for Anila McKenna, an experienced diversity officer, for informing my thoughts on this subject. I'd like to acknowledge the examples of excellent practice that are clearly evident, especially at grassroots, club and association level. We can learn from the good, and with a collective will and responsibility, we can improve across all sporting disciplines, not just in cricket. As a starting point, the review includes many practical and deliverable recommendations, and I acknowledge the work that is already underway by Sport Scotland and urge them to proceed in partnership with organisations that have expertise and experience to offer. And this may well help to rebuild trust and confidence. I welcome Cricket Scotland's commitment to have a new board to be in place by the end of this month. Now, let's be clear. Racism exists everywhere in society. But what makes an organisation institutionally racist is not that it has racism. It's whether its priorities, tackling it and being actively anti-racist in its policies, procedures and cultures, or remains passive, content with a never-ending cycle of deny, defend, deflect, on repeat. Even if we never truly understand the experiences of others, it is important to strive to be an ally. Paul Reddish, who is here today, OBE, talks of allyship as standing up for those when they are not in the room and handing the microphone back when they are present. And I am minded, Presiding Officer, of the words of Nelson Mandela. Sport has the power to change the world. It has the power to inspire. It has the power to unite people in a way that little else does. And in allyship, we must strive to share the pitches, the tracks, the boardrooms as equals. Looking forward, there is a need for ongoing proactive oversight and scrutiny of sporting bodies and organisations, and to include critical expert voices in that process. One option may be to link into the government's ongoing work on a national anti-racist infrastructure led by Dr. Ema Jackson. A key recommendation of this work is to establish more effective accountability and governance infrastructure in Scotland as the terms of reference state. Too often, recommendations have been made on racism and minority ethnic issues that have subsequently been forgotten and not implemented. They may then be raised again by other groups without reference to what has been asked for before. And this absence of institutional memory within the current system and structures is frustrating, it's disempowering, and can be understood as a mechanism by which systemic discrimination occurs. I believe that governance structures and policies that adhere to and deliver on the McPherson definition of institutional racism should become a statutory obligation for bodies in receipt of government funding. This should be able to be applied robustly across different groups with support from the national agency, whilst recognising the varying size and demographics of sporting bodies. Let's ensure another generation do not suffer from racism with nowhere to go and no hope of redress or apology, but are instead embraced by the sport that they love. We must rebuild trust amongst our sportsmen and women of colour and ensure that we are not discussing the same issues yet again in the next Parliament session. I'd like to thank Kasim Sheikh and Majid Haq for their enormous bravery, and I note that Majid is in the gallery today. But we cannot continue to rely on the bravery of individuals to raise these issues. In closing, Presiding Officer, there is momentum here for positive change. Scotland has given us great sporting successes. Imagine the increased scope of that success if all the potential of all of Scotland's sportspeople was set free from the shackles of discrimination. This is truly a leadership moment. I urge everyone, those in authority, from government to Sport Scotland to clubs and association, to embrace the facts, uncomfortable though they may be and they may make us, and deliver the necessary policies to change them. And I will finish, Presiding Officer, with the words of James Baldwin. Not everything that is faced can be changed, but nothing can be changed until it is faced.
Thank you very much, Ms. Stewart. I know this is an issue about which people quite rightly feel passionate, and it may seem counterintuitive, but I would encourage those in the public gallery not to participate, and that includes applauding. As I say, I appreciate it may be difficult, but that is one of the protocols we ask the public to observe here. So thank you very much, Ms. Stewart. We now move to the open debate, and I call first Pam Gosal to be followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy for around 4 minutes, Ms. Gosal.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would also like to give a warm welcome to everybody in the gallery. I'm honoured to open today's important debate on ending institutional racism in sport on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. And I would like to thank the member, Cookab Stewart, for bringing this forward. I would also like to extend my thanks to Sport Scotland for commissioning the Changing the Boundaries report, Plan for Sport for conducting the review and producing the report, and Running Out Racism for their hard work in condemning institutional racism within sport and for taking active steps to reform the way sporting bodies conduct themselves. Along with the member Kukab Stewart, I am one of the first women of colour to become a member of the Scottish Parliament, as well as being the first Indian Sikh in the Scottish Parliament. It has taken a long time for ethnic minorities to gain a voice, but we have one now. It's strange, we hear talk of fair and an inclusive Scotland, but this report reveals that as one of yet, it's merely an empty phrase and a tick box exercise. Sport brings out many emotions such as competitiveness, joy and pride, but unfortunately, it also has an ugly side that has been known to bring out anger, bitterness and hate. When we think of racial discrimination in sport, we often think of it as abuse from opponents, fan club, but rarely from within the sporting bodies themselves. The Changing Boundaries report is a damning indictment of institutional racism, which still permeates our institutions. The review recorded a shocking 448 examples of institutional racism, with 31 allegations of racism against 15 different people, two clubs and a regional association. The definition of racism used in the report highlights what is often forgotten, which is that there is no process whereby individuals can report discrimination, then there is no opportunity for redress. And without proper reporting mechanisms, how can any organisation know about the extent of racism they are presiding over? In the absence of willingness or fair awareness to implement anti-racist infrastructure, sporting bodies are in effect inhibiting racism to go unchecked. Cricket is an internationally acclaimed sport with top teams from all over the world, such as India, Pakistan, Zimbabwe, New Zealand, and the West Indies, and many more. And yet to see institutional racism and such a lack of inclusion in Cricket Scotland is shameful. I am hopeful that changes to be made as Cricket Scotland, such as a new board and the collaborative working between Cricket Scotland, Sport Scotland, Plan for Sport and Running Out Racism, will see an overhaul of previous lack of oversight and scrutiny. But this is only the beginning. The Changing Boundaries report has highlighted what is missing from many sporting bodies across the country and provided recommendations which I hope will be an eye-opening for many. It is essential that BAME individuals feel valued, feel a sense of belonging and a sense of confidence that this club has in their interest and will condemn and take action. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I hope that we do not wait another lifetime before we see transformational take place. Firstly, boards must be diverse. Only when the boards are representative with BAME people have a voice in the operational processes. Secondly, the Scottish Parliament must take more responsibility for the development and implementation of anti-racist infrastructure. And finally, Presiding Officer, we must incentivise sporting bodies to reassess their operations, both structurally and culturally.
Thank you very much, Ms Gosal. I now call Pam Duncan-Glancy to be followed by Jackie Dunbar for around 4 minutes, Ms Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and thank you to Kukab Stewart for securing this important debate and for the excellent speeches that we've already heard. Thank you. The publication of this report shocked not just Scottish cricket, but the wider sporting community and people across Scotland, not just because of its clear and undeniable conclusion, but because of the force and veracity of which the allegation of institutional racism had been proven and the scale of which it was rife within the sport. It was a devastating publication, a stark reminder that we must intensify our efforts to overcome racism and prejudice. The report identified an astounding 448 examples of institutional racism, with 29 out of 31 indicators coming to light. One study conducted as part of the inquiry found 62% of respondents had experienced, seen or reported incidents of racism or discrimination, with 34% having experienced it personally. This is unacceptable in sport and in our society. And I want to thank the two former international players, Kasim Sheikh and Majid Haj, who's here today, for being brave enough to share their experiences in Scotland. Thank you. Which ultimately led to the inquiry and the report, not least because this was not the first time you'd spoken out, but because I know they themselves have felt previous complaints they made during their playing career had little impact. And we know that Scottish Cricket's governing body is now in special measures with oversight from Sport Scotland and hope that it will be closely monitored to ensure that it demonstrates an anti-racist approach. But we must acknowledge that this problem was allowed to get so bad in the first place. Real change is needed, and so too is scrutiny. To move forward, we must see oversight of the issues of the governing bodies and for the governing bodies, who are often volunteer-run, overloaded with vital responsibilities and lacking the expertise they need to deal with them, supported to end racism and all forms of bigotry and discrimination. Anti-racist expertise and lived experience must, of course, as my colleagues have said, be central to shaping what comes next. And I'm not sure that the organisations themselves have that experience yet, and so the government must do what it can to support them, a key part of which must be that both governing bodies and Sport Scotland must take strides to improve their own internal diversity too. We want a Scotland with all actively anti-racist societies, and sport plays such a central role in this, as it does in our everyday lives. And that's why it's so important that the already agreed anti-racist infrastructure to oversee public bodies will be used to scrutinise sport. Last summer brought rightful outcry as England football players Sancho, Saka and Rashford faced a torrent of online racial abuse following their missed penalties at the final of Euro 2020. So we know it's not only in one sport. And Cove Rangers player Shai Logan has regularly spoken about the racist abuse he's faced throughout his playing career, and still now, and has often shared abusive messages from opposition fans. It's simply unacceptable that this is still going on. And so I was pleased to see the SFA step up following the shocking cricket report, writing to all clubs and making clear that any player or official found guilty will have a 10-match ban. But the solution can't just be simply punishment or piecemeal. It is going to have to be systemic and structural to tackle the root causes of the problem and prevent this in the future. Sport is, of course, an area where we must focus such anti-racist activity because of this report. But also we must focus on it to harness it as a source of community and solidarity, a source of good that's vital if we're to address bigotry and discrimination. And on that note, I'd like to pay tribute to Partick Thistle Football Club and their community trust, whose hard work to promote inclusion is the kind of example we need to see replicated across the SPFL and beyond. Their accepting activity programme run from Petershill Park in Springburn brings people with a range of challenges in their life together to play football. People who are homeless, asylum seekers and refugees, people facing recovery from addiction. Over 50 adults regularly attend every Monday and Thursday, and around 75% of them are from a black minority ethnic background. They're able to play free football, where both training kit and football boots are provided for free too. When the game is over, the players are all provided with food. And the community trust tell me that they've got participants from all over the world: Ghana, Gambia, Syria, Afghanistan, Pakistan, Vietnam, Iraq, and the list goes on. Many of them still have now joined a local grassroots club such as Petershill, Somerston and Knightswood. And also thanks to the excellent work of Jags for Good, a number of these players are now able to access Partick Thistle home games through the free season tickets group this group has fundraised for. Not only is this a gold standard example of using football for good and bringing communities together, but it also encourages diversity from the offset. Sport is a force for good. It should be open to everyone. When we come together and face the uncomfortable truths that my colleague Cole Cab-Stewart spoke about, we can begin to tackle injustice. Presiding Officer, this is a fight for all of us, and I believe that we all in this chamber are ready to take that fight for the good of the people we represent. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I now call Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Brian Whittle for around 4 minutes, please, Ms Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As Deputy Convener of the Rugby Cross Party Group in Parliament, I'm delighted to have the opportunity to speak in this important debate, and I thank my colleague and friend, Cole Cab-Stewart, on securing it. It is regrettable that we have the need for this debate, but it is crucial that we, collectively as a Parliament, send a clear and loud message to all in the sports community that racism has no place in sport, no place in Scottish society, and that racism should be addressed and called out at every level. I want to begin by paying tribute to Majid Haq and Qasim Sheikh, who had the courage to put themselves above the parapet and to bring about the exposure of the level of racism which was seen in Scottish cricket. I also want to thank everyone who was part of the report process. Their contribution in what is a difficult situation is invaluable, and my thanks and admiration go to all involved. This work, I hope, will be instrumental in bringing about the start of a new era, not just in Scottish cricket, but across sport in Scotland more generally. Presiding Officer, the report carried out by the Change in the Boundaries makes for grim reading, and the investigations will be concluded in due course. And it is important that as a Parliament we allow this to happen in the proper way. The report also made several high-level and sub-recommendations for immediate action to address institutional racism in Scottish cricket. These recommendations are crucial, and while I welcome the commitment from the Scottish Government and Sport Scotland to see them implemented, I would welcome an update from the Minister on the timescale for the completion of these recommendations. Similarly, it has been highlighted that presently Sport Scotland have limited powers to address issues within a governing body, who are often volunteer-run and discharged with vital responsibilities, such as safeguarding against discrimination, and I call on them to use these powers to their full extent. Going forward, I would therefore support the calls for safeguards to be built into sports governance to allow for the scrutiny and oversight of boards' activity to ensure that all discrimination is addressed. Although this report on cricket raises significant issues, it is important to also look to the future and to the positive work which the sport community in Scotland has undertaken to tackle racism and discrimination. Indeed, as the Managing Director of Plan for Sport stated, whilst the governance and leadership practices of the organisation have been institutionally racist, the same should not be said for cricket in Scotland. There are many outstanding clubs and individuals delivering local programmes which truly engage with diverse communities. I also welcome the Scottish Government's funding and support for Scotland's Sport for Life, equality, diversity and inclusion approach. This approach provides meaningful internal action and leadership to Scotland's sporting community to tackle racism and all other forms of discrimination. Scottish Rugby have picked this up particularly well, and I congratulate Scottish Rugby on winning the Sports Equality Award for the work they do across their clubs to celebrate diversity and to cut our discrimination. I ask the Minister for a commitment that this work will continue and that the Government will redouble its efforts to tackle racism. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, as Martin Luther King Jr. said, I look to the day when people will not be judged by the colour of their skin, but by the content of their character.
Thank you. I now call on Brian Whittle to be followed by Paul McLennan again for around 4 minutes. Mr. Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I thank CoCab Stewart for bringing this debate to the Chamber? And in her speech, CoCab Stewart quoted Nelson Mandela when he said, sport has the power to change the world. It has the power to inspire, the power to unite people in a way that little else does. It speaks to youth in a language that they understand. Sport can create hope where there was only once despair. It is more powerful than governments in breaking down racial barriers, and it laughs in the face of all types of discrimination. Now, those of you who had to endure my stumbling speech last term in the Black Lives Matter debate may recognise that quote, because I used it there. I think it's extraordinarily powerful, because sport can be such a force for good. It is the tip of the spear when we're tackling inequality, be that of colour, creed, religion, sex or gender. Sport is about viewing something through the prism of performance and excellence. Sport is about what we have in common with each other, not what divides us. Sport is a way of society when accepting our differences. In the end, the only difference sportsmen and women are interested in is our ability to perform, recognising the dedication and the effort in delivering in the arena. Presiding Officer, as you may know, this is a very personal debate for me, having witnessed friends of mine suffer racial discrimination over the last four decades or so that would put the current situation in a whole different light. 40 years ago, the world was very, very different. I ran against the first two black men that I met. Both of them were heroes of mine at the time, and are now, I'm glad to say, lifelong friends. Scotland wasn't the diverse country it is now becoming. And I was just thinking, I've actually coached athletes from India, from French Guyana, which I have to say really tested my schoolboy French, Polish athletes, Iraq, just to name but a few. It was unheard of 40 years ago, and I'm always delighted to see my own local athletic club with athletes from such diverse backgrounds. The younger generation these days are much more integrated and informed than we ever were at that age. Back in the early 80s, many black and ethnic sportsmen and women suffered in silence for fear of being excluded from teams, and it was extraordinarily hard to witness. But if you think about society back then, television programmes were full of casual racism. It was the norm to have words and phrases dropped into conversations that would make us recoil these days. I suspect, and I really hope, that the current situation is that of unintended casual racism, which has had to be endured and thankfully has eventually been called out, which is, of course, what we must continue to do whenever it rears its head. That is an education issue, and to be honest, I think a generational issue to a certain extent. What we must guard against is the fact that racism is a learned trait, and we must continue to tackle that. Let's not fall into the trap, though, of thinking that racism is a thing of the past. Just consider, as Pam Duncan Glancy said, the appalling treatment of the young black English footballers who missed penalties at the European Championship. Presiding Officer, at the top of my speech, I said that sport can help to change the world. I'm thinking of real pioneers in sport, people like Jesse Owens back in 1936 in front of Adolf Hitler. Cassius Clay, Olympic boxing gold, goes back to his country into segregation. Arthur Ashe in tennis, with a stadium now named after him. Tiger Woods in golf, winning at the Masters, where only a few years previous black men were not allowed to play. They shone brightly and are remembered because of their sporting prowess. Now, that doesn't mean to say we've not got more work to do. After this year's European Championships, I was approached by a complete stranger on the street who indignantly inquired of me, are white men not allowed in the team anymore? And I have to say, I use language I would not repeat in this chamber, Presiding Officer, but it does give us a reminder that we have so much more work to do. So can I thank Colcab Stewart for bringing this debate to the chamber to remind us once again that racism still pervades our society, despite the huge steps I've seen over the last 40 years in the sporting arena. Let us continue to use sport and music and art, incidentally, to highlight what binds us and what connects us, because ultimately we should respect and celebrate individuality, the things we should be judged on are our actions and performances. Sport is such a great leveller, Presiding Officer. It's why I'm so passionate about investing in it and promoting it. It's not about teaching our children to do sport. It's more about teaching our children through sport. Yeah. Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Whittle. I now call Paul McLennan to be followed by Gillian Mackay for around 4 minutes, Mr. McLennan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank Colcab Stewart for bringing this debate forward tonight, and her passionate speech really moved me, so thank you. I'm sad to be speaking in this debate tonight. We shouldn't need to be debating racism in cricket because it shouldn't be happening. But the sad fact in this instance has been institutional in cricket for many years. In preparing for this debate tonight, I attended a briefing on this by Sports Scotland, which I'll touch upon shortly. But we were also briefed on this issue by Running Out Racism. So, who are Running Out Racism? They describe themselves as a group of cricket players, administrators and fans, cricket lovers. They want the current coverage in cricket in Scotland to lead to changes in the way our institutions are run so that racism of all forms in cricket can be eradicated. We want to be part of that solution and to have our say in what happens next. So it's fantastic to see so many people in the gallery tonight. My thanks, sincere thanks to you for all for raising this issue and the bravery in doing so. The Running Out Racism briefing highlighted the following things, and this is the main important things that they've said going forward. All of this happened with Cricket Scotland winning various diversity awards and with continued budgets and oversight signed off. This demonstrates issues in oversight and governance of governing bodies. Cricket Scotland lacked both diversity and expertise to take things forward. It's critical that anti-racism expertise and voices of lived experience are both involved in the action planning. There needs to be safeguards built in that can provide scrutiny and oversight to such issues. At the moment, Sports Scotland have limited powers to address issues within the governing body, who are often volunteer-run and discharged with vital responsibilities, including racism, discrimination, safeguarding and the like. And also the plans to implement the already agreed anti-racist infrastructure to oversee and support public bodies, approaches to ensure Scotland can become an anti-racist society, are used to provide scrutiny to sport. And finally, the focus for this infrastructure is for all policy development and implementation in health, education, housing, and equally applies to into sport and culture, given its current profile and challenges. Now, other people have talked about other sports, and other sports do need to listen from their view of racism into the sport. I coached football for over 25 years, 15 years of those in the professional game. Over that period of time, I've seen several racist incidents. As a football fan and a Hibs season ticket holder, sorry to mention that, I've heard racist abuse being directed at players. One of these players was a guy called Kevin Harper. Kevin was the first black player, one of the first black players in Scotland and one of the first black players for Hibs. I've spoken in person on lots of issues and it still affects him now, all these years later. Last year in my constituency, I was contacted by two constituents, 1 week after another, about racist incidents in two amateur football games, 1 week after another, who were frustrated at the lack of action by the Scottish football authorities. Following that, I arranged three round tables, which included the Sports Minister, Marie Todd, and all the football governing bodies, the Scottish Football Association, Scottish Youth Football Association, Scottish Junior Football Association, Scottish Amateur Football Association and the Scottish Women's Football Association, and also a couple of the senior clubs, Hibs and Hearts in the area. At that meeting, I discovered that SFA have one person only employed to look at diversity and racism issues, including policy, incident reporting and liaison with clubs. The SFA does have an Equalities and Diversity Board. Now, that group meets quarterly and is keen to get a wider understanding of different issues if the work that's carried out. In comparison, in England, all Premier League and Championship teams must have full-time diversity offers. Now, I understand and appreciate there's more money in English football. These full-time diversity offers look at issues of racism, misogyny, homophobia. That's extending to League One also during the course of this season and League Two the season after. The Scottish footballing authorities need to learn from the experience of Scottish cricket in dealing with issues and how Sports Scotland dealt with that, and do more to tackle racism, sectarianism, trans and homophobia and misogyny in our sport. In closing, I commend Sports Scotland for their work, including in other sports, particularly football, needs to do more. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr McLean. I now call on Gillian Mackay to be followed by Fazil Chowdhury for around 4 minutes. Mr Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank CoCab Stewart for bringing this important debate to the Chamber and for her passionate speech earlier on. The Changing Boundaries report is damning in its conclusions, and as others have said, the wealth of evidence was undeniable. I think it's worthwhile noting that Plan for Sport, who conducted the Changing Boundaries report, had almost 1,000 interactions with people to hear about their experiences. And I'd like to thank each and every one of those who did come forward and share their stories about the impact that Scottish cricket has had on their lives. The report found the leadership practices and governance of Cricket Scotland to be institutionally racist. The report also found 448 instances that demonstrated institutional racism. Like so many colleagues across the chamber, I express my deep concern at these findings and solidarity to those who experienced this institutional abuse. No one should be made to feel unsafe, unwelcome or abused in sport. We must ensure that those who have experienced or have witnessed racist incidents have the confidence that their reports will be taken seriously and crucially acted upon when they come forward. That Cricket Scotland have won various awards for diversity is a further cause for concern and demonstrates we cannot be complacent about the perceived progress we've made on equalities in Scotland. We cannot be content with any progress we've made while racism still thrives. Going forward, it is essential that the safeguards we build in to provide the additional scrutiny and oversight needed in Scottish sport take account of the limited powers that institutions such as Sport Scotland currently have in being able to effectively explore and address racism across different governing bodies. Where vital responsibilities are discharged over areas such as safeguarding racism and bullying in governing bodies, it's essential that institutions that lack effective expertise across their boards, which can often be small or reliant on volunteers to function, are fully supported in these endeavours. The Scottish Greens share the view that genuinely impactful equalities and anti-racist strategies should be central to organisations that receive government funding. Further to that, I welcome the assessment framework that is set out in the report, and I share the view noted in CoCab Stewart's motion that this could be effectively used as a conditional part of funding criteria for all funding of sport in Scotland. I look forward to the response of the Scottish Government on the proposed anti-racist infrastructure model, which we currently understand is being considered and potentially published next year. This report will inform on oversight and how to support public bodies to ensure Scotland can become an anti-racist society. I'm pleased that some measures are already being taken to provide oversight to Cricket Scotland until October 2023. Cricket Scotland is undertaking an immediate recruitment process for new board members and for additional staff to ensure the effective operation of new equalities measures and the undertaking of a governance review. It's vital that the voices of those with lived experience are part of this process. We must also remember that cricket will not be the only sport that these issues have taken place in. This should be a wake-up call to all governing bodies and taken as an opportunity to stand together and say that racism will not be allowed in our sports teams. And although I have spoken about the structures and teams involved, we should all remember the impact that this will have had on individual players, their lives, their families, and the love of their sport. I hope that all those who have come forward are getting the support they deserve. I'd also like to thank Running Out Racism and other organisations such as Show Racism the Red Card and Kick It Out for their campaigning efforts to bring this important issue to bring this important issue the public attention that it deserves, and to thank all of the people who joined the rally outside Holyrood to make their voices heard that racism has no place in Scotland. As parliamentarians, we must tackle these prevalent challenges in all areas of public life. We must continue to be vigilant in the face of discrimination and address any form of inequality head on. Sport should be a welcoming place for everyone. Racism and all other forms of bigotry and discrimination have no place in Scottish sport and no place in Scotland.
Thank you. I now call Faisal Chowdhury to be followed by Rona Mackay for around 4 minutes, Mr. Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I would like to thank CoCab Stewart for bringing this matter, very important matter, to the Chamber. Thank you, CoCab. Here we go again, Presiding Officer. Another investigation, another organisation found to be institutionally racist, and long list of actions to be taken. In 1999, the McPherson Report noted that institutional racism is the collective failure of an organisation to provide an appropriate and professional service to people because of their colour, culture, or ethnic origin. Since then, positive moves towards equality have been taken, and I applaud the work of campaigns such as Show Racism the Red Card and Kick It Out, which encourages the end of racism within sports. 23 years after the 1999 McPherson Report, however, racism is still present across society. Recently, we have seen stark inequality laid bare in the Scottish Government's Equality Impact Assessment into its Race Recruitment and Retention Action Plan. Now, institutional racism in sports, most recently within the Cricket Scotland, has been brought to light. Institutions that receive government funding must be held to account and must promote anti-racist equality practice. In institutions that their boards must not be given awards whilst failing to uphold standards of fairness, equality, and accountability for those they serve. It is unacceptable that Cricket Scotland was winning diversity awards whilst 448 cases of institutional racism were happening. The report details of allegations of favouritism towards white children from public school within Cricket Scotland. I commend those who shared their lived experience of racism within the sports, including former Scotland international Majidul Haque and Kazim Sheikh. Doing so has helped to expose the realities that racism does still exist in Scotland and that something needs to be done now. I hope that in the future it will be easier for other victims of racism to share their experience and be supported in doing so. I welcome reports that many clubs do support diversity and equality. However, more needs to be done so that this culture of equality is present within all clubs and indeed across sports. Institutional changes is needed to weed out institutional racism and introducing roles such as diversity officers and independent complaint mechanism within sports could be a good start. The Plan for Sports report, while shocking and extremely disappointing, it is a wake-up call about the reality of racism in sports and Scotland today. We need to use the opportunity of influence to the future for both Cricket Scotland and for other sports bodies and institutions within Scotland. Now is the chance for the Scottish Government to prove that they take institutional racism seriously, and instead of offering piecemeal recommendations that do not go far enough, are instead committed to overhaul racist institutions and practice throughout the nation and within their own institutions. This is the time for all of us to work together, and I am committed to joining any discussion that the Scottish Government might have to influence meaningful action that could end institutional racism in Scotland and in Scottish sports. I'm a cricket lover and I have played the game myself. Sports should be an exciting, enjoyable pursuit for children and adults alike, and we should not be allowing a culture where people feel that they cannot succeed in or enjoy sports because of institutional barriers against their skin, colour, religion or cultural background. I want to see a strict law, monitoring and methods to ensure changes. Racism in Scotland has gone for long enough. Now is the time to deliver change. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chowdhury. In order to allow the last speaker in the open debate to contribute, I'm minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 8.14.3 to extend the debate by up to 30 minutes. And I invite Cokab Stewart to move such a motion.
I move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. The question is that the debate be extended by up to 30 minutes. Are we all agreed? Thank you very much. That is agreed. That's not an invitation to take up to 30 minutes, Ms. Mackay. Around 4 minutes, please, Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I thank my friend and colleague, Cokab Stewart, for bringing this hugely important debate to the Chamber, and indeed for our long-standing work in combating racism throughout society generally. I'm delighted that her motion received such amazing, widespread cross-party support. Presiding Officer, the fact that this debate is about ending institutional racism in sport is shocking. The fact that it's been proved that there is institutional racism in sport is shocking. And the fact that it took two international cricketing whistleblowers, Kazim Sheikh and Majid Haq, to speak out until this was acknowledged is beyond shocking. Kazim Sheikh describes the day the report was published and he sat in front of a press conference as the most difficult of his life. He shouldn't have had to do that. His complaints about racism had been ignored until they were endorsed by the Sports Scotland report. Presiding Officer, that speaks volumes. Cricket's governing body and even some fellow players had turned the other way when complaints were raised. A case of see no evil, hear no evil. Presiding Officer, as we've heard, the Sports Scotland report reveals 448 institutionally racist incidences. 448. Let that sink in. It's shocking. There is no doubt that cultural change is required. Uncomfortable truths must be confronted, and we can only hope that this is the watershed that's been needed for so long. Cricket Scotland's entire board resigned on the eve of the Sports Scotland report. The sport's now in special measures. They have until the end of the month to develop an action plan and will remain in special measures until at least September 2023. subject to delivering outcomes that demonstrate an anti-racist approach. And the irony of all this is that all of this happened with Cricket Scotland winning various diversity awards, as Gillian Mackay has highlighted. It beggars belief and it devalues the very purpose of these awards, which, in my opinion, in 2022 shouldn't even be needed if we were a truly diverse population. Presiding officer, sporting excellence has nothing to do with the colour of anyone's skin. Outdated and racist attitudes have no place in Scotland or anywhere else, for that matter, and those who perpetrate them should be called out at every opportunity. Yesterday, I spoke in a members' debate brought to the Chamber by Liz Smith when we celebrated the success of Team Scotland at the Commonwealth Games, and there was much to applaud, and that's in stark contrast with today's debate. So how do we move on from this sorry state of affairs? Presiding officer, I don't pretend to know what goes on behind the scenes of sporting bodies. I can only comment on what has been made public, and it seems to me that both bodies have traditionally lacked both diversity and expertise to take things forward. And of course, the voices of lived experience, in my opinion, the most important people to have at the heart of any forward planning. Safeguards must be built in to provide independent scrutiny and oversight. I understand that at the moment, Sport Scotland have limited powers to address issues within a governing body who appear to be all-powerful. This has to change, and I hope the measures being proposed are effective. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, we know the problem of racism in sport doesn't exist just in Scotland or just in cricket. But as a small nation who consistently punches above its weight in the sporting arena, we must address it now and eradicate it for good. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. McCall. I now call on Marie Todd to respond to the debate. Minister, for around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to thank CoCab Stewart for raising this motion about what is a really important issue and a significant moment for sport in Scotland. The Changing the Boundaries report was more than uncomfortable to face, frankly. It was distressing, it was shocking, and it was utterly damning. Tonight's debate has covered a lot of ground, and while I'm encouraged by some of the positive stories, I'm under no illusion that there is a long way to go to ensure that sport is truly inclusive and welcoming for all. Let me be absolutely clear. I firmly believe that there is no place for racism or for discrimination of any kind in sport or in wider society. Nelson Mandela has been quoted by a number of colleagues, and I think his quote bears repeating. Sport has the power to change the world. It has the power to inspire, the power to unite people in a way that little else does. It speaks to youth in a language they understand. Sport can create hope where there was once only despair. It is more powerful than governments in breaking down racial barriers. It laughs in the face of all types of discrimination. Sport is the game of lovers. Now, I really, really believe that this can be the case. Sport can unite people, and sport can be a leading light in tackling some of the ingrained inequality and unfairness that we have in our society. Being involved in sport and physical activity is so beneficial for people's physical health, their mental health, and their social health. It helps to prevent heart disease, strokes, diabetes, and a whole lot of cancers. It plays an important part in helping us to maintain a healthy weight. It makes a really positive contribution to good mental health, helps to reduce stress, improve self-esteem, self-efficacy, helps to manage depression and anxiety. Sport also strengthens communities. And that's why I believe it is vitally important that everyone in Scotland feels welcome in sport and has the opportunity to be involved. Sport is a critical part of improving the health of the nation, but it's also a critical part of creating a fair and just society. Now, I was saddened, angry, distressed to read about what many have experienced in Scottish cricket. Last week, I met with the interim CEO from Cricket Scotland and Sports Scotland to discuss the Changing the Boundaries report and the recommendations and the associated action plan. I was genuinely pleased to hear the progress so far and how they plan to proceed. The board recruitment process is underway for a chair and two non-executive directors, and I know that they're promoting these roles widely to reach directly into as diverse an audience and communities as possible. The governance review will be commenced once board members are in place. The action plan is being developed and an equality, diversity and inclusion task force is being established. Now, the Cabinet Secretary and myself have been absolutely clear that we expect to see this progress continue, and we'll be undertaking regular meetings to hear of the progress. We're also looking forward, along with the Minister for Equalities, to our forthcoming meeting with Running Out Racism. That's an organisation, which others have said, which was established after the concerns about racism within Yorkshire cricket were raised, and it's done a huge amount to support all the people who have experienced racism within cricket. I want to give my heartfelt thanks to each and every person who spoke to the review and who described their experience. Now, I know that can't have been easy. Fundamental to our response to this report is the need to listen to those who have bravely spoken out and to ask them about the changes that they need to see take place in cricket and sport. And I have confidence that Sport Scotland and Cricket Scotland absolutely understand the importance of that work. I know that they are willing and positive about working with others to bring about change. I'm also grateful to Sport Scotland for appointing Plan for Sport to undertake the independent review so quickly after allegations surfaced, and for their commitment to this work. Now, of course, as many have said, racism is not confined to cricket, just as racism is not confined to sport. Sport Scotland are speaking to all Scottish governing bodies of sport about the issues raised in the report, and they're supporting them all to consider what needs to happen in their own sport. My own feeling... Certainly. Brian my Whitten. Own sense, let me just complete this, my own sense is that this will just have lifted the lid and we're peering inside and we'll see a grim picture replicated throughout sport. Yes, Mr.
Apologies,
Whitten.
Brian Whitten.
I'm very grateful for the Minister for taking the intervention. I've been listening to the debate today, obviously, with great interest. I keep hearing this idea that Sport Scotland don't have the powers that they require to tackle racism. I'm thinking about my own sport. To be an affiliated club within Track and Field Athletics, you have to have a trained welfare officer at each and every one of the clubs. And to be a coach in that club, we have to undergo, every time we renew our licence, an equalities course. Is that not something we should be thinking about replicating across the whole of Scottish sport?
Minister.
So certainly there are good pockets of work in many sports, and we've heard about some of them today, but what we need to do is take a systematic approach to this right across the board and make sure that there is no sport and no place for institutional racism to thrive, as it clearly has done in cricket. We absolutely need sports to ensure that they are truly inclusive of the communities that they take place in. And as many have said, that needs to be from the playing field right to the boardroom. We have to do more. It needs to include not just people who are involved in sport. It's not just that they have to educate themselves about racism, but they have to understand about unconscious bias as well. We all need to be active in our attempts to root out racism. That passive sympathy is just not enough. Now, I have to acknowledge that there is a lack of trust in the organisations and the processes, and given the level of institutional racism that has been exposed, that does not surprise me. I understand this. We have to work to rebuild that trust by listening to people with lived experience and to act to ensure system change. This is such an important issue, and it's important to everyone in this chamber and the communities that we serve. This report has made absolutely grim reading. It's a low point in Scottish sport, but let's hope that this low point can be a new beginning. I'm open to all ideas about how we might work together to collectively make a difference. I'm more than happy to continue cross-party discussions and to update colleagues regularly. I'm very keen to hear ideas on how we take this forward. I'm keen to understand where gaps exist and strengthen structures where they need to be strengthened. We are listening. We're having more detailed conversations about the issue and engaging with stakeholders right across a range of issues, from race to safeguarding. Finally, I want to thank everyone who has contributed to the discussion tonight, and again thank my colleague Kokab Stewart for bringing this motion to the Parliament. But mostly, I'm very grateful to the many people in the gallery and the many people watching at home who shone a light on this issue, who made us all feel uncomfortable. I promise you, we will do better.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.